Hospitals, we all know, is a leader and pioneer in integrated healthcare services. E-health point, you've heard from Amit, his initiatives in telemedicine on how he manages to connect rural patients with doctors in urban areas. Neurosynaptics, a leader in providing the telemedicine solution and software. They have indigenously created a remedy and a device which enables this telemedicine solution and has received several awards for its path-breaking work. 1298, we again know that it is aiming to provide ambulance services accessible to anyone, anytime and anywhere. MDIL is an organization that believes that access to basic information on health issues can empower people to make positive outcomes in their lives. It provides healthcare information via text message, mobile web browsers, and interactive digital content. I now invite the panel to actually to take forward the discussion on how to bridge the healthcare gap through innovative models and partnerships. Gautam.
I would like to invite our moderator, Mr. Gautam Ivathiri. Gautam is a founder and managing director of Signal Point Partners, which works to deliver essential services in emerging markets using technology. Signal Point Partners has set up a new healthcare service called Mira Doctor in India. Prior to Signal Point, Gautam was a manager at CGAP, the Global Microfinance Center at the World Bank. There, Gautam founded and led a $26 million social venture program to scale up mobile branchless banking in countries such as Philippines, South Africa, Pakistan, and India. On the panel, we have Mr. Nandu Madhava, a CEO and founder of MDIL, Mr. Sameer Sarvarkar, CEO, Neurosynaptics, Sri Anil Swarup, IAS, Director General, Labour Welfare, and Joint Secretary, Ministry of Labour and Employment, Government of India, Dr. Ashwin Nayak, co-founder and CEO, Vatsalya, and Mr. Rajat Goel, founder and CEO, IQ.
So the way we'll structure this panel, I think we probably have, 45 minutes, an hour or so? We'll divide it into three parts. So the first part, we'll ask each of our five panelists to give us a very short kind of elevator pitch explanation of what they're doing, as well as we'll ask them to answer a question, which is, in this journey that they've had as entrepreneurs of various types, what is a big lesson that they've learned? What have they taken away from this experience? We think a lot of us would like to hear that. So that'll be the first part of the panel. Second part, I, as the moderator, will ask each group of healthcare models a specific question. So we have Mr. Anil Swarup, who is representing kind of a public-private partnership type model of healthcare delivery. I'll have a specific question for him. And then I'll have a specific question for Ashwin and Rajan, who are here representing low-cost hospitals. And then a specific question for Nandu and Sameer on technology-enabled models for healthcare delivery. So three questions to the panel. And then the last 20 minutes or so will open up for questions and answers from all of you. And we'll take a few questions, and then we'll let them answer the questions. So if that sounds good, let's get started. Sameer, do you want to start us off with a quick elevator pitch on your business, as well as a lesson learned as an entrepreneur?
Sure. Am I audible? Pardon me if I'm a little verbose. I hope I'll be able to complete it quickly. But Neurosynaptic Communications is a technology company. We work to enable access of healthcare, quality healthcare, to the rural areas and remote areas. We do it with technology, and we do it in an end-to-end manner. The genesis of the company is, of course, with Professor Ashok Jhunjhunwala's group at IIT Madras. From the time we started looking at the rural healthcare problem and saying, can we address this with technology, to the point where we are now, where we realize that technology is probably a great enabler, but not the only thing that is needed in the solution. We have made great progress in starting from the place where we did a lot of experimentations to the 700 village centers which are e-healthcare enabled today in parts of the country, reaching out to the last year number alone, about 100,000 consultations done with the help of the central facilities where the doctors address the needs of the patients from all these village centers originating. And there are various forms of technologies that we use, including the mobile, the stationary clinics, the sort of tertiary linkages, including various healthcare delivery mechanisms from our partners to reach the patients to the appropriate places for care. So I wouldn't talk much, but probably unfold things when there are questions and so on. As far as challenges go, do you want me to take the challenges part now?
Yeah, lesson learned.
Okay, so there were various challenges, and initial part of it, I would actually like to quote two things here. The first one, when we started the very first center in the Tirupattur district of Tamil Nadu, on one of those community service centers, and we started this clinic with a doctor connecting to the back end, the village center operator trained up, and publicized in the village, and expected everything to go very nice. We had very, very nice turnout in the day one, day two, day three, and then suddenly patients started falling to the extent that in the next week we had absolutely no patient on the first day. And we tried to figure out what is causing this, and we quickly figured out that there was no medicine shop there. And though the consultations would happen very well and the doctors would be able to tell exactly in 75-80% of the cases what the patient should do, there were no mechanisms to carry it forward. That was the biggest first lesson learned. I think the amount of ecosystem linkages that are necessary to carry out the healthcare delivery to the last mile are really, really necessary, and without that, any technological intervention and anything that we do in the field is probably not going to solve any of the problems. The second one was quite an interesting one, and this is at some other place where we visited, and what I saw is there was an introduction of a glucometer in a telemedicine solution. And quickly after 15 days of introduction of a glucometer in the telemedicine solution, the operator started going out into the village, and this operator is absolutely not a qualified operator, but just sort of a paramedic. And they started doing tests on their own, and they started prescribing the medicines that the doctors had prescribed earlier through the telemedicine or some other facility that we saw. And this gave us a very big lesson of what actually makes sense in the village level, and what actually can be a safe introduction of technology in the villages. And from then on, we went on to create a concept of safe medical devices, safe telemedicine devices, which actually can be placed in the villages, can be monitored for their operation, and that has gotten on into an international patent today, which probably also can get into standards someday, especially for rural healthcare. So these are a few notable lessons that I would like to mention here.
Great. Excellent.
Thanks.
Thank you so much. Next, I would like Mr. Anil Swarup, our distinguished guest and the champion behind the RSBY program, to share some thoughts in his capacity as a government entrepreneur, forced entrepreneur.
Thank you very much. We've done a small experiment in India. The challenge was whether the public and private businesses could get together to deliver a service on scale. And so we started the scheme called Rashtriya Swasth Bima Yojana. I'm so glad that doctor is from Varanasi sitting here, and she had some nice words about the scheme. This was a challenge to us, because most of the pilots that have been started in terms of healthcare or using IT applications in healthcare, those pilots never flew. There were pilots, pilots, and pilots. And when we talk in terms of this country, we are talking in terms of more than a billion. So if we talk of a million, it's nothing. If we talk of 10 million, it's nothing. What are we trying to do? So scale it. And that's the challenge we had, and so we launched this scheme called Rashtriya Swasth Bima Yojana. It's a cashless, paperless, first ever paperless health insurance scheme anywhere in the world. Smart card based health insurance scheme, where smart cards are actually delivered on the spot, printed on the spot and in the villages, on the ground. So far we've 90 million people. More than 1.7 million people have already visited hospitals and got cashless service. I think the unique feature of the scheme is empowering the below poverty line family. By empowerment, I mean He now has a choice to visit any of the public or private hospitals anywhere in the country. And the number today of these hospitals is about 8,000, more than 8,000. So this is his empowerment, because in most of the schemes of the government, which are purely government run, the beneficiary doesn't have a choice whether it's a public distribution system, he's tied to a shop, whether it's NREGA, where he's tied down to a particular project. Here he has a choice to determine. So he becomes the king. And I think the second unique feature of the scheme is, it is probably the first ever business model for a social sector scheme. That was quite a huge challenge. Public funded, private operated scheme, and doing reasonably well. The scheme has been picked up as one of the top 18 schemes in the world by the UNDP, ILO. It's now traveling to countries like Bangladesh, Pakistan, Maldives, Nigeria. All this has happened in the period of 3 years. And people ask me how and why did it happen. Probably this was the first ever service, or you can call it a product, designed by the government, taking into account the characteristics of the target group that we had in mind. The person was poor, and hence he couldn't, so the scheme had to be cashless. The patient or the beneficiary was illiterate, and hence the scheme had to be paperless. Unfortunately, there was no paperless health insurance scheme, but IT applications allowed us to do that. And most of these people are migrant, they migrate from one state to the other. Now, the benefit should be available to him for a person migrating from Bihar to, say, Punjab or Haryana. So this was a challenge which I think we did manage to meet successfully. But what has really happened is that this was the first ever attempt to manage, to go in for a demand-side management of healthcare. In India, we've been pumping money into public sector hospitals without looking at the demand-side management. And fortunately, there have been some very positive fallouts, and some of you might be interested here. A large number of private sector hospitals are coming in back of the beyond. And I asked one of the entrepreneurs, and I asked him, why are you going in these areas? He said, sir, you are pumping in 5 crores of rupees per annum in this particular district by your premium. If this guy falls ill, he's going to go somewhere. I have a business opportunity there. So it's the hospitals are coming up gradually though, but it's happening in the field. It's been a very, very exciting journey so far. Very difficult one. If I had known that 3 years ago, I probably not have got it.
Next, we'll ask Ashwin from Vatsalya to share his experience, his pitch about the company.
So we run hospitals in tier 2, tier 3 towns, basically feeding off on programs like RSPY and other government programs. And we've been running this for 6 years. We are in the states of Karnataka and Andhra, and just about to expand into other states of the country. A couple of learnings we've had is, one is the synergistic sort of relationship we've had with the ecosystem partners, particularly insurance companies, government, private providers. When we started off, we used to do about, even now, 95% of our customers pay out of pocket. But when we started off, about 2 to 3% of our total revenues used to come through some kind of subsidy or some kind of government program or a insurance program. Today, in less than 4 years, we are getting about 20% of the revenues from an alternate financing mechanism. That's a phenomenal learning for us, and also makes us believe more in the power of partnerships with people like government and public institutions. That is one big learning. The second learning that we have had is, when we think about smaller towns, we think that we could take our learnings in a metro urban setting and just force fit into a smaller town. I think that we have seen backfiring for us and for others. I think you have to look at what is the need at the local level and design your services appropriately to the local needs. And another learning related to that is, we also learned that we can't be everything to everybody in that town. So we also, within the smaller geography of tier 2, tier 3 towns, we are focusing on a smaller segment, and there is still a lot of things that needs to be done, whether it is below the poverty line or above the poverty line.
Thank you.